I am Laura Dixon, and you are listening to the Naturally Thin for Life podcast, episode number 92, the Overeating Trifecta. Welcome to the Naturally Thin for Life podcast. I'm going to teach you how to get out of your diet brain so that you too can be naturally thin for life. No counting, restricting, or obsessing. I am going to take the mystery out of it for you so that you can become naturally thin starting today. Are you ready? Let's do this. Hello, friends, and welcome back to the podcast. Today, we are going to normalize overeating. So many of us, driven, successful, ambitious women, we tell ourselves this lie. I have my life together. I have the career I want. I'm so successful. It doesn't make sense that I struggle with my weight. But when you understand what I'm going to teach you today, it actually does make sense that you struggle with your weight. And no amount of being hard on yourself will lead you to the ease of being naturally thin. It's like trying to think you can restrict, and then finally find freedom all of the sudden and have it show up at your door. It doesn't work that way. You can't be hard on yourself and then have it become easy, just like you can't restrict your way to the freedom of being naturally thin. Being hard on yourself, self-loathing, telling yourself you should have figured it out already, none of that stuff has worked yet, and so it's not going to work in the future either. So from today's episode, I want you to take away some compassion and understanding for why you struggle so that then you can take what I teach you today and make the changes you want. Before we dive in, quick reminder, make sure to subscribe to the podcast so you're always getting the latest episodes. And if you're loving the podcast, take a minute to write a review and leave a review. I would love to hear from you. I was actually just reading a review and she said, my spouse and I listen to this podcast to rewire our food brains. And then she went on to say, this is next level and so helpful. And she said a few other things. And I love it. All the spouses listening in. I will tell you, I actually do get a lot of messages. And I don't know if her spouse is a man or a woman, and it doesn't matter. I do get a lot of messages that spouses, and men in particular, listen quietly in the background with their wives. So good. Being naturally thin is how we are all designed to live, man or woman. And maybe I will do an episode on that someday too. Anyways, back to why overeating is normal and not something to be ashamed of. I call this the overeating trifecta. First, your brain is designed to be a super efficient computer. You do something once and it doesn't kill you, and you do it again and your brain is like, okay, that works well, you're still alive, I will automate that for you. The primitive part of your brain that keeps all of our habits going and runs our processes for us in the background where we don't really have to think about them much, like walking or your heart beating, and then a lot of the habits that we have, they all live in this primitive part of our brain that doesn't distinguish between a behavior that serves your highest, best, future, naturally thin self and a behavior that simply doesn't kill you. It doesn't have this lens of, oh, this is a behavior I really want to keep doing, versus, oh, we just haven't died yet from this behavior, we should keep doing it. It puts them on the same playing field. It just thinks, oh, well, we're not dead yet, must serve us. So when you eat the Doritos every night at 9 p.m., when you're feeling stressed out or restless, and you do that for a few nights, your brain thinks, okay, this is just what we do. This is a thing I'll repeat, hasn't killed us, seems like it's a good thing to keep doing. Your brain will then go and start to automate some of those habits, even though they don't serve your highest, best, future, naturally thin self. This is the first part of the overeating trifecta, your brain's natural design to be really efficient. And so many of us, we don't even know how to distinguish between behaviors that serve us and behaviors that don't when we learned some of these behaviors at a really young age. A lot of times when we're young, depending on our age, we haven't yet developed our prefrontal cortex that can think really rationally and think out into the future and think about the habits that we want when we're 20 years from now, right? When we're 5, we don't have that developed part of our brain. And so our brain will literally start to go and develop and become really efficient with these habits that don't serve us when we learn them from a young age. And it will do it still. When you're 30 or 40 or 50, eating the Doritos, multiple nights in a row at 9 o'clock on the couch. It will start to go and automate those behaviors. So, first part of the trifecta, brain efficiency. The second part of the overeating trifecta is the dopamine release that happens in your brain when you eat food. And in particular, when you eat food that doesn't serve you. All food releases dopamine in your brain. We get a reward for eating. We get a chemical release. In our cave days, we stayed alive because we got this reward. It actually allowed us to survive. Imagine being in a cave, worried about animals threatening you. You just want to stay safe in the cave. The dopamine we get when we eat is a reward that incentivizes us to leave the cave and to be able to overcome that emotional fear and therefore keep us alive. We needed the dopamine release to be able to go out and get food, to give us that incentive so that we would actually go out then and get the food. And babies have this too. They get a dopamine release from the milk they drink, which they need that release to remember to incentivize them to go back and get more milk. It's how they stay alive. So it's an intrinsic reward system to stay alive. But here's the thing. Think then about the dopamine release on a scale of 1 to 10. 1 being not much of a dopamine release and 10 being a lot of dopamine. Food that grows in the ground or animals we eat has a dopamine release of, say, a 4 on the scale of 1 to 10. It's nice. Processed food, the food most of us overeat with, that we have cravings for, sugar, flour, those types of foods, have a dopamine release of a 10. Our brain is like, whoa, that was fantastic. Shocker. Food companies know this. No wonder soda and sugar and so many things are addictive because our brain gets so much of a dopamine release. So now you have a brain that's designed to be really efficient and continue to do things even though they don't serve you, but just because you've done them before. And you have a dopamine effect and an inflated, a natural dopamine effect from processed food. Here's the third part of the trifecta. Positive emotion. You reinforce your brain efficiency and you reinforce the dopamine effects when you associate really strong positive emotions like calm, relaxation, comfort, fun, celebration, excitement with overeating. I'm not talking about eating. Remember the podcast on eating versus overeating? I'm talking about the positive emotion you associate with overeating. You actually have a positive emotional response, even though your body is physically uncomfortable, because you associate overeating with relaxing, comfort, calm, fun, decompressing, those type of emotions. The emotions you create, and remember these feelings, emotions and feelings I use interchangeably, they are caused by the thoughts in your brain, the sentences in your mind. When you have thoughts, there are neurons that fire together, and those thoughts send a signal to another part of your brain that releases peptides in your body, and you create the feeling. You actually feel that vibration in your body. Most of you think the food creates the emotion of calm, relaxation, fun, excitement, comfort, but it is your thoughts about the food that creates the emotion. And the emotions in your body, especially strong positive and strong negative emotions, is how your brain remembers most things. Think about your memories. The strongest memories in your brain are the ones associated with the strongest emotional responses. So when you have a strong, quote unquote, positive emotion associated with overeating, associated with eating when you're not hungry, eating past the point of being satisfied, eating a lot of food that doesn't feel good in your body, when you have a strong positive emotional association, even though you have physical discomfort in your body, guess what it does? It takes the brain efficiency, trifecta piece number one, and the dopamine effect, trifecta piece number two. It takes both of those pieces and it bolts them into your brain. Think about the positive emotion, just taking that brain efficiency and the dopamine effect and really making it solidified in your brain. So it's no wonder you overeat. Can we all just agree on that? When you understand the overeating trifecta, it's not a surprise that it feels like it just happens to you some days. Being hard on yourself and telling yourself, but I'm so successful, I shouldn't struggle with this, and then trying to override the positive emotional response you've associated with overeating, trying to override that with pressure or self-loathing, will never work. The positive emotion is too strong. So now you might be thinking, like, great, that sounds impossible to overcome. What do I do now? It's actually quite simple. And the overarching premise of what I'm going to share with you on how you're going to overcome this without willpower and self-control and being really hard on yourself is this. Your body has an innate desire. Your body wants to feel energized, light, airy, and comfortable. That desire from your own body is stronger than the overeating trifecta. So all we are going to do is lean into that desire to grow that desire, and it will automatically override the desire to overeat. In the Naturally Thin for Life program, I teach you in a very structured way exactly how to do this step by step, what tools to use, how to evaluate your progress, how to make being naturally thin simply a part of who you are so that your brain efficiency is now a naturally thin brain rather than an overeating brain. But here is how you can get started now. I want to share some of this with you here so that you can take this in a really simple way and get started right now. The first way you're going to override the overeating trifecta, the first way you're going to grow that innate desire of your own body to be naturally thin when you feel comfortable, when you feel energized, when you feel light and airy is this. You want to make your decisions about food based on how you want to feel in your body before you eat, and how you want to feel in your body after you eat. Physically, how do you want to feel in your body before you eat? And physically, how do you want to feel in your body after you eat? And then you think about what food will allow you to do that. And then you make that decision ahead of time. When you make your decisions about food ahead of time, based on how you want to feel in your body before you eat and how you want to feel in your body when you're done eating, you use your prefrontal cortex in your brain. This is the part of your brain that makes you really human. It's the part of your brain that allows you to think about the future, to think about your naturally thin self, to think about your goals, to plan, rather than relying on your primitive brain to make the decisions around food for you in the moment when you're really hungry. Remember, your primitive brain, it's really efficient right now at overeating. It's done all of that in the background. It's just kind of running for you. So don't let that part of your brain make all of your food decisions when you're really hungry. You want to make your decisions around food in advance based on how you want to feel in your body before you eat, how you want to feel in your body when you're done eating, and then decide what food will allow you to feel that way before and after you eat. And what happens then when you do this and when you make those decisions in advance is your primitive brain unlearns the overeating thought patterns. And instead then, because your brain wants to be really efficient, it's like, oh, those thoughts, the way we were overeating before, you're not really doing that anymore. And instead, the way you're thinking about food is this new way. And you've been doing this over and over again. You've been making your naturally thin food decisions when you decide your food in this way from how you want to feel before you eat and how you want to feel when you're done eating. So now what happens then is your primitive brain is like, oh, I guess this is just the new way we think about food. You unlearn the overeating in your primitive brain and you replace it with naturally thin food decisions when you make them in advance for a while first. And that then becomes your new brain efficiency. It is why I never spend any mental energy thinking about food unless I'm hungry. because now my primitive brain, it's learned. We just don't think about food unless we're hungry. I've utilized that brain efficiency to serve me. I just had to teach it first to unlearn the overeating way and to learn the naturally thin way. And now it just thinks naturally thinly automatically for me. It's fantastic. So you can unlearn the overeating and learn the naturally thin way of eating simultaneously. If you haven't listened to the podcast called The Buckets, listen to that episode. I walk you through exactly how to make these naturally thin food decisions in advance without much planning, really, at all. You're not going to measure or count and give yourself some crazy meal plan. You're really going to focus on how you want to feel before you eat, how you want to feel after you're done eating, and you're going to give yourself some options for some food that serves you to feel how you want to feel physically in your body. Okay, so now you're making your food decisions, your naturally thin food decisions, in advance so that you teach your brain to use the part of your brain that has the best interests at heart, your prefrontal cortex that thinks about your naturally thin self. You're using that part of your brain to make these decisions, and your primitive brain is going to start to pick those up automatically. That is step one. Now, there are only two steps. You are not going to do anything about the dopamine piece of the overeating trifecta. If you're looking around like, what? Don't I have to get rid of everything processed and never let my partner or kids have it around because it's just so tempting? Like, I have to get rid of all of this food that has so much dopamine. You told me it has a really strong dopamine effect. Nope. Actually, you don't. We're going to skip over all of that. There is nothing you need to do with the dopamine. And here is why. Step number two is all about feeling your feelings. That is why I purposefully, for all of you, did a podcast episode on how to feel before this episode. And if you're thinking, don't know about this feeling thing still, you're really going to get on board after I explain it to you. So you want to hang around. And I want you to consider this before I dive into step two, where we're going to talk about your feelings. Think about another example. I'm going to give you a non-food related example. Think about the chemical release you get during sex. You get this amazing oxytocin hormonal release. You have these strong chemical releases that are incredible. They're physiologically in your body. Just like dopamine, you experience physiologically in your body. But with sex, if you associate the emotion of shame with sex, the feeling, the emotional vibration of shame, you associate that with sex, even though you get a chemical release that is incredible, that shame will often prevent you from getting that chemical release. That emotion of shame, and I'm just using shame as an example, is stronger than the hormonal release. It is the same with the dopamine of food. The emotions associated with overeating and the emotions you associate with not overeating are stronger than any dopamine effect. So you do not need to focus on the dopamine. You do not need to meticulously look at all the food in your cabinet and decide what's going to have the strongest dopamine effect, and I need to throw it out, and I can never put myself in any situation ever again where there's processed food that's going to tempt me with this dopamine. No. The reason I shared with you the dopamine effect is just so you can understand why your brain is overeating. But there's nothing you actually need to do to focus on that piece of the trifecta. All you're going to do instead is you're going to make your naturally thin food decisions in advance, like I talked about in step one. And then now in step two, what you're going to do is you're going to associate an emotion with the physical comfort of feeling light, airy, and energized in your body. You're going to associate an emotion with that physical feeling in your body that's stronger than the emotion you've associated with overeating. Where so many people go wrong is you try to use a stronger negative emotion. You try to use shame or guilt or regret or self-loathing or being super hard on yourself or pity or trapped. You try to use those emotions to try to override your overeating. It will never work. You want to associate a really strong positive emotion with feeling light and airy and energized and comfortable in your body. That will so much more easily override your desire to overeat. Remember, your body wants to feel this way. Your body wants to feel energized and optimal and airy and comfortable and all of the things that you feel when you're naturally thin. It's why when you overeat, you feel the physical discomfort. It's why you feel uncomfortable. That's your body talking to you, telling you, hey, I don't like that so much. Your body wants to feel the way you feel when you're naturally thin. Some of the emotions I associate with the feeling of being naturally thin, with the physical feeling of the light and the energized and the comfort in my body, some of those emotions are freedom, ease, effortlessness, calm, presence, love, peaceful, trusting. It is so much easier to be present in your body when you feel comfortable in your body. When you're present in your body, not only do you feel the physical, light, airy, energized feeling, the physicalness of it, but you also then feel the emotional vibration of what you're feeling emotionally. You feel the calm, the presence, the love, the ease. So that is what I really want you to do instead. Not the beating yourself up, not the being really hard on yourself, but to associate those really strong positive emotions with the physical comfort of being naturally thin. Then here's the other thing you're going to do. You're going to associate a negative emotion with the physical way you feel when you overeat. And I'm going to really caution you on this. You are not going to hate on yourself. So you're not going to use self-loathing. You're not going to use shame or regret or guilt or embarrassment. None of those. All of those emotions are actually more uncomfortable for most of you than the discomfort of overeating. So when you experience the emotion of regret, guilt, or shame, and you don't know how to feel those emotions without needing a distraction, guess what? You eat. Because those emotions are so much more uncomfortable for you to feel than it is the physical discomfort of overeating. So you're not going to use any of those. Instead, I want you to associate emotions like maybe a little disappointment or a slight annoyance or a deflated feeling like, ugh, it's just not the greatest when I have the physical discomfort of overeating. Maybe it's an emotion of a little bit tired or lethargic. So you want to think about emotions on a spectrum, and you want to associate really strong positive emotions with feeling light and airy and energized and comfortable. And then on that same spectrum, you want to choose emotions to associate with the physical discomfort of overeating that are more neutral, but maybe lean slightly negative. Like something that's just, yeah, it kind of is what it is, but it's not really my favorite, those kind of emotions. So when I overeat now and I feel the physical discomfort, and yes, I do still overeat sometimes and feel a little bit of physical discomfort, I don't automatically go to, I'm a terrible person and feel shame. I don't automatically go to, oh, I'm going to put all of the weight back on and feel hopeless or trapped. And I also don't tell myself, oh, I shouldn't have eaten that again and feel a ton of regret. None of that. Instead, it sounds more like, oh yeah, that just isn't my favorite to feel this way. I don't like feeling this way. It feels more like a subtle reminder when I have the physical discomfort of overeating of, oh yeah, that's right. I just don't like this. It's as simple as that. And then I love feeling light, ease, calm, motivated, energized, comfortable, in love with how my body physically feels when it is in the way I feel, in the naturally thin way, when it's light and airy and energized and comfortable. It's so easy to get back there. Imagine a spectrum of emotions. To get from deep shame to love is a really long way in the moment of overeating on the spectrum of emotional vibrations in your body. Let's imagine deep shame is on one end and intense love for your body is on the other end. And when you start overeating and you automatically go to shame and you associate shame with physical discomfort in your body, you've got a really long way to go to get to love. But instead, to go from feeling slightly annoyed that I overate and just not my favorite, to calm, not so far to go on that same spectrum. It's a lot easier to interrupt overeating, to feel slight physical discomfort from overeating and then to stop, rather than to be in intense shame or regret or embarrassment and then to try to get yourself all the way to the other side where you're trying to love yourself. It's so much longer of a journey for your emotional vibrations to get to. Being naturally thin is easy and effortless. When you make naturally thin food decisions automatically, because you've trained your brain to do so using the buckets I teach you, and when you have such strong emotional responses with feeling good in your body, that your desire to feel uncomfortable in your body, it just can't compete. It's that simple. When you love the feeling of feeling good in your body more than you ever love the feeling of any physical discomfort. That is how being naturally thin becomes simple and easy. That is how you can see a piece of cake and you may decide to have a couple of bites and you may easily stop. Or you may see a piece of cake and just decide, not today. Because of how you've associated your emotional responses with how you physically feel in your body. Now, even though it is simple, that doesn't mean it's always easy to get to that ease and effortlessness. There will be some bumps along the road, as in some uncomfortable emotions will come up. There always are when you make a change. You will have some of those uncomfortable emotions that come up along the way, and it's not a problem when you know how to feel them. Embracing those uncomfortable emotions, embracing the restlessness at 9 o'clock and still deciding not to eat, embracing the urge to eat when you aren't hungry, embracing the frustration at work and allowing those vibrations to simply pass through your body, like I taught you in the How to Feel episode, that is the fastest way to the emotions you do want, to the emotions you want to feel when you're feeling the way you want to be physically in your body. There is no getting around quote-unquote uncomfortable emotions. We're all human. You're always going to have some of them. But when you associate such strong positive emotions with how you want to feel physically in your body and you know how to feel uncomfortable emotions, the desire to overeat simply goes away. Now, I'm going to take a minute for all of you thinking, I don't have time for feelings and those feeling people, like, I sort of kind of get it, but it's just really not for me. Hang on. I'm going to sell you on this if you aren't there yet. I was recently talking with a woman in the Naturally Thin for Life program, and she had some of these similar thoughts, and I've had them too for the majority of my life. Feelings like, I don't really have time for that. I'm not like an airy-fairy, talk about my feelings all day kind of person. And so anytime people would talk about feelings / emotions, I'd be like, I'm more of just a doer. I have some people in my life, both now and in the past, and I'm sure in the future, that I would have described like this, where they just love to talk everything through. They love to talk about how they feel, what they're thinking about, what they're afraid of. They go to make a decision, and it's this intense thought process that they just love to talk about. And they love to talk about their feelings associated with it and what's going on in their mind and what could happen with this and what could happen with that. And like, it goes around in a circle sometimes. And sometimes when they're talking to me, in my mind, I'm thinking, just do the damn thing already. Like, so I get it. But here's what I told this woman when we were talking. And so I want to share it with all of you if you have this similar thought process that you're not a feeling person and you don't have time for that. You simply have a misconception about feelings and emotions. People that love to talk through everything in the most painful amount of detail and take forever to take action, they actually are terrible at feeling their feelings. They actually don't even understand their feelings. They aren't in touch with their emotions because here's why: they fear them. The only reason when we have this stereotype about other people that like to just talk and talk and talk and not take action, the only reason they are talking instead of taking action is because they don't know how to feel the emotion between them right now and them taking action. The only thing that's ever between us and taking an action we want to take is an emotion. For example, right before I started writing out this podcast episode, I went to a page on my website where when you go to sign up for the Naturally Thin for Life program, it has all the information and the videos and the sign up and it has all the things. And I go to this page, it's all jacked up. I'm like, what happened to this page? It's all messed up. Like the fonts are all over the places. Like it literally looks like a kid like messed it all up. I made a tweak a couple of days ago and it messed something up on the back end. I'm not sure exactly how or why, but it did. And I maybe sort of think I know what I did to mess it up, but totally messed up. It looks terrible. I felt a lot of panic in my body. I was running a promotion and sending all of these people, tens of thousands of people, to this specific page on my website. And so I had a lot of thoughts with a lot of panic. So I am feeling the vibration of panic in my body. Now, when you take the stereotype that a lot of us have of quote unquote feeling people and it being soft, people that like to talk about their feelings, and then we tell ourselves, I'm just really not that person. If you take that stereotype of that type of person that likes to talk about everything and talk about their feelings, here's what might have happened. They probably would have freaked out, been paralyzed. Call someone to talk about it. Maybe they would have called tech support in their panic. Maybe they would have called their partner and told them, oh my God, like this is just what happened. What do? I don't know what to do. And maybe then their partner doesn't answer because they're at work. So then maybe they decide to call their friend, and then maybe they text their friend, and then maybe they call their mom, and then they go get a snack because they just don't know what to do because they're just freaking out. Maybe then they even bury their head in the sand and tell themselves, I'm just going to deal with this later. I'm just feeling so much panic right now. They would freak out and do nothing because they're feeling panicked, and maybe they would go around and talk about their panic. That person doesn't know how to feel their feelings. They fear the vibration of panic in their body. They fear their emotions. They fear their feelings. Now, I'm not going to say panic is my favorite emotion, and I felt it whoosh in my body and was like, yay, this is amazing. But I felt the vibration of panic. I closed my eyes for about 2 seconds, saw my brain freaking out. And then I used the tools that I teach every single one of my clients on how to feel your feelings. I let that vibration of panic be in my body, did not make it a problem. It was there. And I got to work. I did first email someone in tech support from my freaking out. And then I thought, you know what? As I was feeling the panic and I was just letting that vibration be in my body, I thought, actually, you know what? I know how to fix this. And in about 15 minutes, it was fixed. It was done. I didn't sit around talking about my feelings. I just felt the panic. And then I moved right through it and I took a lot of action. It is the fear of emotions that creates the stereotype many of us associate with quote-unquote feeling people. When you really know how to feel your feelings, you never need to talk about them with other people. Now, of course you do, and especially with your family and people that you might be intimate with, and maybe your children, you talk about your feelings and the people you're really close with and the people you want to be vulnerable with. But when you know how to feel your feelings, you don't walk around talking about them all the time. You're too busy taking action because you're not afraid of them. So if you're thinking you don't have time for feelings, you actually don't have time to not be feeling your feelings. When you have no fear around emotional vibrations, around feelings in your body, you just get to work. You take so much more action. You are so much more efficient. You actually spend way less time talking about things, working things out, slowly kind of making decisions, you make decisions so much more quickly. You get to your goals so much faster because you are a feeling person. So now go out there, make your naturally thin food decisions ahead of time. Associate incredibly powerful, amazing emotions with the physical feeling of light and airy and comfortable in your body, and some of those more neutral-leaning emotions with overeating. That is how you overcome the overeating trifecta. If you want all of the tactics and tools and a step-by-step plan to make being naturally thin become easy and effortless and lifelong for you, then make sure to come and join us in the Naturally Thin for Life program. Listen to the outro for more information on how to join. Friends, I hope you all have an amazing day, and I will talk with you all next week. Friend, if you are loving what you are learning here on the podcast, you have to come check out my Naturally Thin for Life program. It is my on-demand lifetime access program where I teach you brand new concepts not taught here on the podcast, and I will walk you through exactly how to implement all of the tools I teach you here so that they become just a part of you. You will learn exactly how to understand your specific brain and your specific body so that you become naturally thin for the rest of your life and you no longer struggle with your weight. Inside of the Naturally Thin for Life program, you can also receive live help so that you consistently make progress and reach your goal. I will teach you how to accelerate your naturally thin journey in a sustainable way so that the change becomes permanent. The best part is that it's risk-free. You either love it or I will give you your money back. If you are ready to finally be naturally thin for life, join us at lauradixoncoaching.com/workwithme. That's LauraDixon coaching.com, and click on the Work With Me tab. I cannot wait to see you there.